Many immigrants to the US hope to provide a better life for their children. Indeed, this is a key component of the American dream. But to what extent are they able to achieve this? Many first-generation immigrants earn less than US-born workers upon their arrival and fail to catch up over their lifetime. Are their children able to do better? This paper studies the intergenerational mobility of the children of immigrants. How do these second-generation individuals compare to the children of US-born parents? The authors focus on three cohorts of immigrants spanning 130 years of US history. The first two consist of 4 million immigrants observed with their children in either the 1880 or 1910 U.S. Census. These children are linked to their adult outcomes in the 1910 and 1940 census, respectively, using information on name, year of birth, and birthplace. The third cohort consists of children of immigrants born around 1980. Outcomes for this group are sourced from data made public by the Opportunity Insights Project and augmented with data from the General Social Surveys. Several aspects of these data are worth highlighting. First, because children in the census data are linked to their adult outcomes using their name, women are harder to track as many change their last names after marriage. Therefore, the paper focuses on linked father-son pairs. Second, the census did not collect income data before 1940, and so the authors estimate individual income in these cohorts using a rich set of variables, including occupation, age, and state of residence. Finally, these data span a period that saw many dramatic changes in US immigration. While the earlier cohorts largely emigrated from Europe during a period of near open borders, the modern cohort entered amid substantial immigration restrictions and came mainly from poorer and more ethnically diverse countries in Latin America and Asia. Thus, a key focus of the paper is whether the intergenerational mobility of immigrants has changed between the late 19th century and today. To start, these figures show, for each cohort and by country of origin, the average earning gap between first-generation immigrants and US-born workers. For example, in the 1880 cohort, immigrants from Scandinavian countries faced the largest earnings penalties, while those from countries such as Italy, Portugal, and Scotland tended to out-earn US-born men. Throughout the time period spanned by the data, the earning gap generally varied over a consistent range, even as the composition of countries at the top and bottom of the distribution changed. What is notable, however, is the pattern that emerges when we add the average earning gap between second-generation immigrants and US-born workers. In each of the three cohorts, and for most of the sending countries where first-generation immigrants earn less than US-born workers, second-generation immigrants close or even reverse the earning gap. In these cases, the children of immigrants out-earn the children of the US-born. These patterns in average earnings are suggestive, but the paper's primary results leverage the father-son links available in the data. The next set of figures show the relationship between a son's rank in the income distribution and his father's rank, displayed separately for sons with US-born fathers and sons with immigrant fathers. And we see that in both the past and the present, the children of immigrants are more upwardly mobile than the children of the US-born. Conditional on the rank of their parents, children of immigrants have a higher expected rank in adulthood. This is especially true among poorer families. For example, the children of immigrants whose parents are in the 25th percentile of the income distribution have the same income rank in adulthood as the children of US-born parents whose income rank is 15 to 20 percentiles higher. Notably, these patterns are remarkably consistent over time. Here, the authors restrict to fathers in the 25th percentile, divide the data by father's birthplace, and then calculate the son's expected income rank in adulthood. In all three cohorts, and despite the many changes in US immigration over this period, sons from nearly all ascending countries consistently have a higher expected rank in adulthood than the children of US-born individuals. These figures replicate the same exercise, but condition on fathers in the 75th percentile. Here, the sons of immigrants and the sons of the US-born appear more similar in terms of upward mobility, especially in the modern period. This indicates that differences in upward mobility are particularly pronounced at the bottom of the income distribution. So, why are the children of immigrants more upwardly mobile? A key factor is geography. Both today and in the past, immigrant parents are more likely than US-born parents to move to areas with high rates of upward mobility. In fact, differences in upward mobility between immigrants and the US-born fall by 50% when comparing children growing up in the same US region, and disappear entirely when comparing children within the same county. In conclusion, this paper shows that the children of immigrants have greater upward mobility relative to the children of US-born parents. This is especially true among poorer families, and location plays an important role in explaining these differences. These patterns are remarkably consistent across different countries of origin, different ethnicities, and different time periods. This suggests that many immigrants to the US do achieve better prospects for their children. To read more on this topic, you can check out the paper's references to other related work. These include papers on immigrant assimilation in the US, those studying the age of mass migration, and research on intergenerational mobility more broadly.